Thank you. And good morning, everybody. We certainly had a nice evening event yesterday, but I have a big audience already. That's great. You know, the first picture, should it be a green apple? Because it's always a sour apple that a speaker has to eat after a great evening event. I thought, should I show you that picture? And then I decided not to. Quantum physics and the paranormal. Human beings at the focus and the sights of the universe. That's my title. I'm a natural scientist, I'm a chemist, and also a long-term science journalist. And today I don't want to torture you with formulas and stuff like that. I'd just like to kick off the day by giving you the bigger picture of this whole field. This whole field that's the topic of this Quantica meeting. I'll take you from the big structures of the universe into the smallest structures in the human body. I'll take you into the molecules, into the tiniest particles, and I'll take you back into the macrostructures again. And I'll just try and find out where there's interferences, and where we're connected to the universe. And I'll also try and give you some examples illustrating that. Maybe this is good for some great inspiration between heaven and earth. That's where we are. This is a picture taken this winter. I didn't take it. We spent our vacation elsewhere and we didn't have that panorama, not quite like here, but this is in the Swiss Alps, in the mountains, and that really shows you a nice valley, shows you our biosphere here, and at the same time, you know, at sundown we can see the moon coming up, and then we have Venus, the bright spot above, and both locations are not very inviting. They're outside of the zone of life. Why? Well, I'll try and go back to that later. But I think, you know, you might not be interested in astronomy that much, but I think it's still fascinating. You cannot withdraw from the fascination of the sky, of heaven. And this is a long-term picture, and it's the full moon over there, that bright spot. It's not the sun, and it's the Milky Way and the different stars, and that's above Tenerife. And in 1986, together with my wife, I went to La Palma, another island there, early in the morning, and then we saw that this is really a very elevating feeling when you can really see the Milky Way all the way into the horizon, and where you have a very clear sky. And then all of a sudden you feel like you're one with nature and the cosmos. I'll also be looking at something else, like how we are linked and connected with the cosmic structures. What do you know? What do we know about the universe? I mean, people have been focused on that ever since the first days of the world. People have always been following the stars, observing the stars, and even in ancient times, people have been interpreting them. And with the help of modern telescope, like the Hubble Space Telescope, and that's a beautiful picture of the Orion fog. Here you can see condensing gas clouds that contract, and planets are generated from that. And these areas, these regions in the universe, are actually stars, involving stars. And I'll show you that this universe is programmed for life. And there's many different possibilities that we have, probably, to actually prove that there's life out there. This is 500,000 light years away, this structure. That sounds like a giant distance, which means the light that got emitted here, the light that we see now, the way we see it now, that's what the Orion fog looked like 1,500 years ago. We have no chance to actually find out what it looks like now, at this moment, because we need light for that information. And there's also other things that you can actually observe with the help of the space telescopes. The earliest recognizable structures in the deepest depths of the universe, they come from a distance where light takes 13 billion years to reach us. And you know, imagine that. Our Earth is only 4.3 billion years old, and the light that we perceive here is 13 billion years old. You know, the Big Bang happened 13.7 billion years ago, and that's only like 700 million years away from that. So here, we're looking into depths of the universe that we never believed possible in earlier days. But still, there's a big difference. A big difference. But I don't want to give you only astronomy and elements of astronomy. I'd like to take you on a tour, a journey. I'm calling it the Magical Mystery Tour. And of course, I grew up on the Beatles back in the days of puberty, so I remembered that. That's why I chose this title. And now I'd like to invite you to join me on a tour, a journey that's going to be taking us from the macro to the microcosmos and back again. I'd like to show you in what ingenious way the smallest modules of matter are connected and why we are active members of a communicating universe. This gentleman that you see here, that's the British physicist Thomas Young. It was in 1802 when he carried out an important experiment. In his day, we still didn't know what exactly light was, what it consisted of, and he was the first to prove the wave nature of light. I guess this is not going to make you jump off your chairs. But this is more important, his experiment. The experiment he carried out was the so-called double slit experiment. And this experiment is still very important to this very day in later experiments that I'll outline to you in a moment. And here it's all about experiencing something, learning something about the true nature of our matter too. And in 1961, this double slit experiment was done with electrons for the first time, tiny matters, tiny particles. And it was positive because we were able to prove that even electrons have a wave-type nature. They're not just particles, they also carry waves. And in September 2002, there was a survey of the English Physical Society, and it turned out that this experiment was the most beautiful experiment of all times. Why? Well, here you can see it. You know, this is a somewhat more modern version or setup of this experiment that Young carried out so beautifully. And I mean, yesterday, some of the speakers already mentioned this experiment in their presentations, so I'd just like to mention it again here for a better understanding. This is it. This is a ray of coherent light which passes through a double slit, and contrary to the usual expectation, like if waves were not present in light, then you'd also be expecting two bright beams behind those slits. But in reality, you can see an overlapping pattern. And that's a clear indication of a situation where light comes in waves, so-called interferences, generated by the superposition of waves. There's cancellation and reinforcement if waves meet each other. And you can see that by looking at this characteristic pattern here. And you can also see it very nicely in nature. You know, all the little duckies on that lake. We even have a song on that in German. And from each duck, we have a wave front that propagates. And here in the middle, where they meet, we have superpositions, you know, the interferences. Let's now move into the other possibilities offered by the double slit experiment. Some of the possibilities for us to look at the character, the nature of matter. Here I'd like to look at Professor Zeilinger, Vienna, and his team. I'd like to mention them first because they were able to show that this wave corpuscle dualism doesn't just happen in electrons, very small particles, but also in bigger molecules, for example, in fullerenes. What are they, fullerenes? Well, here you can see a fullerene molecule, which consists of 16 carbon molecules. They are arranged in a cage-like structure. It's pretty new. They first got discovered in the 1980s, the fullerenes. And then here next door, right here, you know, you might have walked up there, there's like MBI for nuclear physics. It was a nuclear physicist who actually proved that there were fullerenes for the first time. And the Nobel Prize was given to a chemist because unfortunately that guy was a nuclear physicist and of course he wasn't given the Nobel Prize. But you know, he actually made important contributions. Anyway, this is just a sideline comment here. Back on track. Professor Zeilinger in Vienna, he was able to find that these passive molecules also have waves. They also carry waves in part. And this fullerene molecule, if you really look at that, you know, I just showed you the cage-like structure, and on the left-hand side, we have the same kind of an approach. It really reminds you of a football, doesn't it? And it's actually like a football of microcosmos. And the chemistry is a very interesting one here. It's a so-called 3D supra-aromat, if you know your chemistry here. And there's very interesting products, you know. You could also use it as a super lubricant with certain additives and so on and so forth. But this is another sideline comment, back on track with the waves and the large molecules. Zeilinger, he's really clever, because meantime, he's proved something else. He's proved that quantum mechanic effects also happen in biomolecules like tetraphenylporphyrin. Tetraphenylporphyrin, among others, is the dye vehicle in chlorophyll and hemoglobin. And the next question, of course, is, so how about it? How about viruses and bacteria? Are they also part of the quantum world? And I know this. Professor Zeilinger, you know, at this time he's trying to use the double-slit experiment with viruses. At this time we have no results, not as yet, though. I only have one quote of him on this topic. Like, is there a principal limit, like where the wave corpuscles dualism disappears? And he said, I'm convinced that there's no principal line like that. There's only limits of experimental doability. You know, just saying it, maybe because we have so many physicians here. You know, imagine it turns out that viruses have a wave nature as well. Consequences? Well, we'd certainly have to talk about them, right? If it were so, the wave corpuscle dualism, that's one phenomenon in the particle world. And there's another one too, and that's the so-called EPR phenomenon. Einstein, Podolsky and Rosen, EPR, there you go. It's also called the EPR, the Einstein-Podolsky-Rosen bridge, the EPR phenomenon. What does it say? Well, it says that two particles that once belonged together, well, in a mysterious way, they are connected. Einstein called this the spooky action at a distance. And this means that if you have a particle A and a particle A and B used to belong together, and now you're separating them, and now you change particle A a little bit, then particle B notices that instantaneously with no delay. It doesn't matter how far particle B is away. It could be meters, it could be kilometers, it could be light years. And those two, they behave like one single system. And of course now there's another question. How about this phenomenon? Is it in contrast to classical physics, mechanistic physics? Yes, it is, because two entangled particles are in a close relationship that's independent of the spatial distance, not allowed by classical physics. And yes, because the reaction with regard to a change of state of one particle instantaneously can be detected in the other particle, which means that the reaction is not restricted to the speed of light. And that is something that is really dramatic. It's a dramatic insight. And first it was just a theory, also on the part of Einstein. He helped develop it, and also the other ones, Podolsky and Rosen. That's why it's called EPR, not just Einstein. It's EPR, including the other two names. And a physicist from Geneva, from CERN, who doesn't have anything to do with that big machine, CERN is also doing other things. It was Niklas Giesen, who in 2008, for the first time proved by experiment, that the exchange of information between entangled particles happens at least 10,000 times the speed of light. And that was like the experimental proof, because 10,000 times the speed of light, that was just the natural limit to the measurement equipment that he used in his experiment, that he could realize. So he proved directly that there's really an exchange of information happening at an extremely high speed. Information exchange, I used that term, which is quite provocative. To me, it is an exchange of information if one particle feels that something happens to the other and it reacts instantaneously. In physics, they're always trying to suppress that in order to save the theory of relativity. Right? Yeah. And this is what happens. I mean, even people like Professor Giesen, you know, even in publications, they tried to mention the word above the speed of light. They used a more clever approach. He did too, and he actually published this in a great technical scientific magazine, and he actually made it up to be a comment of a scientific American journalist. And of course, there's degrees of freedom that you have, that we all have, and you don't need to expect that the academic world is going to kill you if you are proving the theory of relativity wrong. And the question is it really proven wrong like that? It's not like it's proved wrong completely. Over the course of the years, we've also looked at Newton's mechanics, like the orbits of the stars. I mean, it's still true by approximation. It's approximately true. But we also know something more. Due to Einstein, it's his fault that certain deviations from the planetary orbits can no longer be explained by classical methods. Now we need to add the theory of relativity. Whenever there's planets moving close to big masses, like Mercury, close to Sun, its orbit can no longer explain by using Newton only. Here we need to apply the theory of relativity. So, you know, whenever there's new insights, new findings that are happening, you have to put the theory to a test. You know, the theory of relativity, it's no good anymore. You can't say it like that. You now have to put it to a test again and review it and apply a new lever, maybe. The theory of relativity is here to stay. But it's just a better version, right? In the current form, a better version if you want. And, you know, he, Giesen, then said personally on this experiment, the experiment with 10,000 times the speed of light, he said there's something really strange that's happening, something outside of space-time. I'm convinced that we're on the verge of a new era, a revolution of the concept of nature and world. Conclusion. So, what can we do? Well, we simply have to assume a transcendent reality in which space-time is embedded. This is not trying to be esoteric here. It doesn't have anything to do with that. It's really a physical reality because completely unexpected interactions happen that can be proved by using quantum physics experiments. And before, I said there's two particles that used to belong together. Now they move apart, but in a mysterious way they remain connected. And you might wonder, well, how about our day-to-day life? What does that have to do with it? There's like a physicist, he's splitting up two parts and then he proves that they used to be connected? Well, there's a big relationship because here we have the Big Bang. And ever since the Big Bang, I mean the particles that existed then, the particles that helped shape this universe all belonged together at one point. And here you can see that again. And I'll not look at too many details, but this is an extremely logarithmic scale. This is the Big Bang right here. Then here you can see 10 to the power of minus 43 seconds. That's the universe. It's still consisting of predecessors of modules of matter. After 1 second here, and then you can see the first atoms that develop after 300,000 years. And then finally, after 1 billion years, here we have the first galaxies that develop, and stars and systems. And I'm not sure where it says 15 billion years, 13.7 billion years. That's the general assumption. And that's the universe, right? And here in the middle, we have the creative human being. And you can see the temperature of the universe, how it's continuously been declining from 10 to the power of 32 degrees Kelvin, and then 3 times Kelvin, which is like with the background radiation. That's also the temperature of the universe because of that. So that's the matter that got created, that developed from out of the universe, from the Big Bang. That's the material side. That's one side. And now I'm going back to what I said before. Like, what does it really mean if we drill down that deep into the universe, if we look into that far? What is the difference between us and the Stone Age humans, if we have telescopes these days? There's one thing that we have in common. Whatever we observe is only just the hardware, always. But how about the software of the universe? Let me ask you that. And now let me just say it this way. The software of the universe, well, it was an information set that was already contained in the Big Bang, a huge set of information that got released. I'm comparing it with the information content included in a single egg, a cell, that's actually influencing life later in a magnificent way. Within the Big Bang, we already have a set of information that's led to the creation of the current universe. It's the code of life of the universe, that's how I'd like to call it. This information, this software is programmed for life. And it's my conviction that at this point, that's where the act of creation of God happened. This information cannot develop from zero. Can't have happened like that. This universe is programmed for life, and that is something that I'll be showing you at a later point again. And now, I'd like to look back at Lothar Schaefer, a quote from him, University of Arkansas, Fayetteville. He said something like, in experiments, it turned out that two particles that had interaction at some point and then moved away from each other can stay connected and behave like a single thing. We said that before. It doesn't matter how far they may be apart. But now here comes the important additional element, the new element. If reality is not local, then the nature of the universe is that of an indivisible whole. And we, well, in a mysterious way, we are connected to this universe. We are members in a participatory universe. We're not just onlookers, we're right in the middle of all this life. We are part of a big whole. And now we're looking at quantum phenomenons, and we'll be looking at certain things that might seem paranormal to us because they're non-causal. And I call this the naive causality trap, because we're used to that, right? You know, we're used to that. Like, when we look at our world, we grasp our world the way it is, from the material side, from a realistic perspective too. And we know certain things. We know that every effect has to have some kind of a cause. A causal event always has a temporal direction, starting out from a cause, then having an effect. For example, an event or state A is the cause of effect B if B is brought about by A. Sounds more complicated than it is. For example, you step on the gas pedal so your car accelerates. And in Newton, it was the famous apple that hit him on the head, you know, because of the force of gravitation. Effects whose cause we do not know, whose cause we cannot understand, are perceived to be paranormal or supranatural. But what's behind that supranature? I don't think we can have something like a supranature. We can only have nature that hasn't been analyzed. Not yet. And now, the core of it all. What's behind certain terms and phenomena such as rare coincidences and precognitions and the effect of homeopathic medication and spiritual healing and swarm intelligence and many other elements like that? How about it? Is it possible? Is it allowed for us to interpret paranormal phenomena to be quantum effects? The physicist Paul Davis from the Arizona State University is convinced of having quantum effects act and have effect even in our everyday lives, from theory to practice. There's a book that I wrote, and you know, over 20 years I was collecting rare phenomena from reliable sources, and unfortunately you can't buy this book in the shop upstairs, but you can get it, you know, everywhere online. You can get it from bookstores too. And it's subtitled Quantum Phenomena and Fate. Can quantum physics explain paranormal phenomena? And Professor Rosenbaum, well, yesterday she gave us a presentation, which was excellent. And she gave us two examples of really very strange, very rare coincidences. And she could say that the probability that this would ever happen is just statistical chance. 1 to 1 quadrillion of a chance. You can preclude it that much, basically. And there's many rare coincidences I was collecting. And now I'd just like to give you just a couple of examples. Here you can see a British cab, a taxi, which has a lot to do with my story now, which is all about a British taxi driver who, after 34 years, came back and met his son again. The 39-year-old customer, his son, was sitting in the back seat of this car. Barry, that was Dad's name, well, he had left his family in the colony of the Crown Hong Kong when his son was 5 years old. And then, you know, because he found out that his wife had been having an affair. So he divorced her, and afterwards he lost touch with his family. Colin grew up believing that his dad was dead. And then Barry returned to England and settled in Brighton on the ocean. Just by chance, his son came to the same town via South Africa together with his girlfriend. He then stepped into the taxi, and the girlfriend saw the license of the taxi driver sitting on the dashboard, and he said, "Isn't that strange? You both have the same name." And Colin jokingly said, "But you're not Barry by your first name, by any chance?" And when it turned out that they were really dead, father and son, they both started crying, and then they decided to really get to know each other. And the other example, that's something that a reader sent me. And he had remained silent about this event, this experience, for 50 years in order not to have people make fun of him. And this is what he wrote to me.
In summer 1958, and it was just before I turned 20, my friend drove me home in my car, and it was only 9 o'clock at night. That was quite early, but it was because my mother said I shouldn't be home too late because Miss Bühle was sick, and she was lying in state downstairs, and so on and so forth. She had died now, and a 20-year-old still listened to their parents, obviously, at the time. My friend stopped the car just in front of the door, and above there were the windows of the staircase, and everybody could look in into the staircase then. And we kept talking about things until I thought I saw my mother in a long white nightgown, and I felt she was walking into the stairway. I said, "Oh, bye-bye, Osh, she'll be upset." When I got out, I realized it was not my mother, but it was the landlady. Funny, I thought, hadn't she died today? But I still went in immediately. And of course, nobody met me there, but that episode just wouldn't let me sleep, so I knocked on my mother's door. And I asked her whether in the last 2 minutes she'd been in the corridor or in the staircase. And she said no, and asked me why. And I didn't dare tell her the truth because I was afraid that she thought I'd gone crazy. Now, 50 years on, I still remember that image. It is as if that just happened a week ago. And a similar paranormal phenomenon was reported to me by a gentleman from Munich. He told me over the phone. And it is a very touching story, really. When I put down the receiver, I noticed that I had shed a tear or two and I needed to wipe them off. And he said, my father was born in 1926, and well, we always had a very cordial relationship. I still remember what my grandmother told me at a time, and that was something that had occurred when my father was born. At the time, of course, my father was born at home. That was the standard at the time. At the time of birth, in the living room next door, there was a dove that had come in because the window was open, and when the midwife opened the door and told the family that a son had been born, the dove took off and winged it through the room. Now, in 2007, my father died after a very serious illness. Because it was very hot when he died, 5 minutes before I left for the cemetery, I opened all the windows of my car because I didn't want to be sweaty when I went into the chapel. When I wanted to start the car, I couldn't believe my eyes because there was a white dove in the back seat of the car, and after a while it flew off agitatedly. And I'm absolutely convinced that with this symbol, my father wanted to tell me that he was going to go on living in another world.
Carl Gustav Jung.
Carl Gustav Jung did not believe in coincidences. He did not believe in chance at all. He thought chance was a phenomenon of a higher order that controlled our life. The synchronicity principle that he has developed explains in which way so-called chance can influence our lives, and synchronistic events are connected with one another in an a-causal manner. There's no chain of cause and effect. And in his collected works, he reports such an incident himself. There was a young patient who had a dream where she was given a golden scarab, and what that was as at an important point of her treatment. I was sitting against the back of with my back against the window while she was telling me, and the window was closed. Then I heard a noise behind me. Something was knocking against the window, I thought. I opened the window and caught the animal while it was flying. It was as analog an animal that could be as a golden scarab. It was a Swiss type of beetle which was similar to the scarab as it could be. And it absolutely wanted into a dark room. Even that would not be a natural behavior for that beetle. A doctor and a systemic therapist living nearby sent me the following case. And he wrote me this. In group therapy sessions, I can sometimes, to a certain extent, induce synchronicity. Let me give you an example. A participant wanted to know under which circumstances he could possibly communicate with his brother again. Communication had been disrupted for 10 years because they had fought about a legacy. And, well, we discussed the subject and role-played for 45 minutes. When he got home that night and when he listened to the message on the answer phone, he had a message from his brother on the phone, who lived 450 kilometers away. And he suggested that they should continue contact now because 10 years of silence were enough. Another example, and a brief one. Norman Mailer, the writer who wrote a book, Barbrechon, and when he was writing, he had the feeling that he needed a Russian spy for the plot. First of all, that Russian only has a sideline job. But as you wrote, this invented spy came more and more into the foreground, and in the end, the story was all about the spy. And after the book was published, the FBI stormed Norman's home and arrested a man in the apartment below him, and it was a top spy from the Soviet Union. Next example, and then I'm almost done. And I called it accident, coincidence, and the question about morals. This is Jurek Becker. He said there are the funniest coincidences. So, for instance, I was coming to a bus stop where there was a young woman who I thought was Gretchen Kosanke, who I'd been to school with and hadn't seen her forever. And so I went up to her and I wanted to talk to her. And then I see from nearby that it wasn't her at all. Well, that happens, doesn't it? But now, minutes later, the bus arrives and who gets off? Gretchen Kosanke. And last example of a coincidence, or not really a coincidence, but a, let me say, a remote perception. And that was by the Swedish philosopher Swedenborg in a contemporary report. He reported a paranormal phenomenon. It was a July night in 1759, and Swedenborg had been invited for dinner at night, a place which was 450 kilometers south of Stockholm. Then Swedenborg paled and he started to get worried. He went into the garden and then came back and said that a large fire had broken out not far from his home in Stockholm. And he said that the fire was spreading and he was worried about some of his manuscripts. Then finally he calmed down and sighed with relief, the door stopped 3 doors from my house. Since some of the people present had homes or friends in Stockholm, they were just as worried as he was. One of them told the governor the same night of the event. And the next day, Swedenborg reported details to the governor. The news of the accident spread around the city, but it took until the next day when a messenger came from Stockholm for the details to be borne out. Well, when I was talking about the phenomena, I mentioned this subject, homeopathy, which is a completely different subject, I must say. So quantum effects do play a role in homeopathy, I can tell you that much. If you ask me at a chemist how these large dilutions work, then I'd have to say, well, mechanically, or not mechanically, but conservative approach from chemistry tells me it couldn't work. It's like the cube of sugar that you put into a big lake and you wouldn't feel the difference. So, of course, chemistry has its own laws, and homeopathy would not be covered by that, so it must be other laws that apply. Now, I have a quote here. This is by Professor Harald Wallach, who used to be head of the section of complementary medicine and evaluation research at the Institute of Environmental Medicine and Hospital Hygiene at the University of Freiburg. He says, homeopathy can be understood as a system which uses double entanglement. Double entanglement. Entanglement exists between the active ingredient and the solvent, which explains the principle of potentization. At the same time, there's an entanglement between the individual symptoms and the remedy picture, which is in line with the laws of similars of the homeopathy. Mind healing is a similar story. I live in Wasserburg upon Inn. We have a very famous spirit healer next door, and at one night she demonstrated very impressively how she healed patients. Patients who had diseases of the bone system or in the joints with classical medicine or orthopedics would have given up. And there are successes too. Well, but how do you explain spirit healing? I have an example here of one spirit healer who, funnily enough, happens to be a quantum physicist. And so he should understand something of the matter. His name is Dr. Lutz Wilde. And he said, as a physicist, I've done experimental quantum physics. As a shaman and spirit healer, I don't do anything else. It's just that my environment and my methods have changed. Now let us now turn to the swarming behavior of animals. The Görlitzes gave an example yesterday. They were talking about birds. And it's a recent publication that I like to get back to. The sense of orientation in birds can probably be explained by quantum physics, is what we heard. Recent work. Now, I have another current example here, the bees, the bee colony. I'll now turn to studies by Professor Jürgen Tautz of the Biocenter of the University of Würzburg. Well, he found that the bee colony is much more than the sum of its constituent bees, as far as intelligence is concerned, and the duration of life of individuals. And he says a bee colony is really just a bee, a superorganism consisting of 30,000 to 50,000 bees, the cells of which separate during the day, fly out, and return overnight, and only overnight, and in winter do they form a unit. Just as cells take over certain tasks in a body, in the same way, bees specialize and divide labor. The only plausible explanation of swarm intelligence is the entanglement principle of quantum physics. Let's now turn to development of life and cosmos. Now, there must be some kind of software in the universe. It can't be just a hardware that makes this universe as it is. Professor Lothar Schäfer, who I quoted earlier, said at a time, the development of life can be understood as having developed from a virtual cosmic order. That order had already been established before it manifested in the empirical world. His belief is that the different forms of life have not arisen accidentally, but they have developed out of a necessity. What's most important in this development is that the complex order of the biosphere is not created out of chaos and nothing, as Darwinists would have it, but by actualization of the virtual order of quantum states, which already exist before they have become reality. Conclusion? The development of life would, in this logic, be an unavoidable step in cosmic development, while the cosmic order holds an enormous potential of possibilities. And that would mean that in cosmos we would really have to come across a great number of inhabited celestial bodies. The people in these planets and moons would have the same genetic code as the life forms on Earth. Depending, though, on environmental conditions there, they would have adapted to their environment, which should be reflected in a great variety of possible manifestations. So, where in cosmos do you find suitable environmental conditions so that the life code of the universe can flourish? You see our solar system here with the planets, Mercury, Venus, Earth, Mars, Pluto is no longer on board. For more highly developed life, the distance to the Sun is paramount. Because of temperature reasons, on the Earth is the only planet, in our solar system at least, that is in the biosphere, the sphere of possible life. Mars is on the fringe, Venus is already outside. Its surface temperature is 450 degrees, and there's no organic chemistry anymore, almost. And the other planets can also not be seen as carriers of life. The outer planets don't have a firm surface. They are gas balls, gas spheres, and simple forms of life, though, might be possible on their moons. Mars, in the early time of its development, it had a hotter phase and a denser atmosphere. The mass is a bit on the slim side, this is why it couldn't hold the atmosphere. But there was an era, and we can still prove that, there would have been liquid water at a time. Maybe there were precursors of life even. And I think this is quite impressive. This is from a probe orbiting Mars, and this is the bottom of a crater. And you see some snow along its rim, close to the North Pole, by the way, of Mars, and that is frozen carbon dioxide, sublimates at minus 78 degrees, and you can find a lot of water ice. So it's a desert planet, but it seems there's enough water on Mars left. And for future space research programs, that is important, of course. You'd need something where water is available. Now, if you look for other celestial bodies in our universe, outside the biosphere, the zone of life, then that life could only develop autonomously if there are very special conditions. This is Europa, which is one of the four Galileo moons, and you can see that there is a very fine network of structures. The surface is frozen ice, water, right, frozen water, and below it is an ocean, water again, and it is heated up by tidal forces. Jupiter is so far away from the Sun that the surface temperature is minus 150, so it's not really friendly to life. But on the inside of the Moon, in the ocean, there just might be life. This is a project which is envisaged for 2020 or so. A probe is to land on Europa. A penetration robot would go through the layer of ice, which would probably be several kilometers thick. There might be some places where the ice is thinner, and then the probe would go into the ocean and would try to find out whether there's any life. I'll be brief now. This golf ball here is a similar body as Europe. That's Enceladus, a Saturn moon. And again, there are tidal forces underneath the surface, and you see many fault lines there, so there is liquid water. And you can see it's nice and white, and the surface is very young, and it keeps regenerating. And the secret here, and it's very nice as you can see it against the light, the moon is full of gaseous. So there's hot water from the inside that bursts out and condenses on the surface. So another candidate. Again, we might send a probe to find out whether there's life beneath the surface. Completely different celestial body here. However, one of my favorites, I must say, that's Titan, the Saturn moon. It's the only moon in the solar system to have an atmosphere. An atmosphere which is even denser than our atmosphere on Earth. It's hydrocarbons, and it is similar, and water, and it's similar to the original atmosphere of Earth. And because this moon is so interesting, a space probe was sent there. That's the Cassini project, to remind you, and the Huygens probe. And Huygens was the one who investigated the Saturn system first. So the Huygens probe went down, and the atmosphere is so dense that regular telescopes, light telescopes, wouldn't show you anything about the surface. It's an aerosol layer, and there are clouds. So space probe landed on that moon, and it was found that the atmosphere was much clearer once you were through the aerosol 10 kilometers down. It looks like a fan, but it's really a mosaic of the best pictures that we got from that mission. Let's begin here. The white spots here, those are low-lying clouds. And here, this is what I'm saying. It's so exciting. There's a coastline. And here, we have rivers. And as we've been able to find, there is precipitation. There's rain on Titan. And this is not a space probe. That was an artist who drew that on behalf of NASA. That's the surface of the Saturn moon Titan, as an artist's impression. And there's liquid, there are coastal lines, there are river runs, there are oceans. The only big difference is, well, Saturn is, of course, outside the life zone. It's beyond Jupiter even. The surface temperature is minus 178 degrees Celsius. And the rain, that is not water, mind you, it's methane. Methane, well, it's liquid at minus 180 Celsius, and so methane shapes the Saturn moon as water shapes the Earth. Yeah, now you could dream up creatures living there. But the question is, could a methanophile life form, a cryophilic and methanophilic life form, could it survive there? Well, I assume that there might be quite interesting prebiotic biology there. As a chemist, though, I must say at minus 180 Celsius, all reactions, well, that's a rule of thumb, yeah. The reaction genetics, if you increase temperature by 15 degrees, reaction speed doubles and vice versa. So chemical processes would be extremely slow at snail's pace. And the question is, of course, what a couple of billion years have done. And I think we heard from several presentations yesterday whether there might not be tunneling effects, and a highly interesting celestial body for you. So, next question, how adaptable is life? Well, I'm not sure whether in the beginning of the year you read the newspapers, because the NASA had reported that they had seen an alien on Earth, a life form with abilities that were thought to be impossible. But this alien was not out of space, but I think it was a lake somewhere in California, I believe. That's where they had found the alien. And this bacterium had something special. Well, the lake there contained a lot of arsenic, and the physiological effects of arsenic are known to you. Maybe you know the film with Cary Grant and his Two Old Aunts, very popular in Germany. And I was talking about the alien, right? And the amazing thing is that bacterium from that lake has a DNA which has replaced phosphorus with arsenic. Isn't that amazing? Well, I understand the chemistry. The phosphorus, or arsenic, I should say, in the periodic system, fifth main group is directly underneath phosphorus, arsenic straight below. Phosphorus, and that was really amazing. That shows how adaptable life is. A couple of other examples here. I call them the extremists, and I'm not talking about politics here. Here we have Aqua Spirillum Arcticum, which is a bacterium which lives in the snow and ice regions in the Canadian Northwest. It has cold resistance proteins. Or Candida Antarctica, which is a yeast, an alkalophile, ophilic yeast, the Vander Lake, by the way, where it's found, is relatively warm, so the cold doesn't come into it. It's even a heat-loving one, but it contains a lot of alkaline, so the pH value is quite high, and that was amazing again. Or another bacterium for you, which was just found in Kamchatka, the Siberian Peninsula, an anaerobic bacterium. And one that I found absolutely fascinating, Deinococcus radiodurans, which is a bacterium which resists radioactive radiation inside a nuclear reactor. And, well, it has developed a repair mechanism so that it can rebuild its cells over and over again. And I hope we won't have the total disaster, and all life forms on Earth found after that will be just that bacterium. A couple of other examples, Shivanella benthica, a bacterium which lives under massive pressure. It was found in the Puerto Rico depth, 10,000 kilometers below the sea surface. And then there's Halobacterium, Halobium, a salt-loving organism which you find in Owens Dry Lake in California. Now, where can we expect more highly developed life forms on Earth? As I said, there must be some sun, or it must be the right kind of sun, rather. A couple of exoplanets have been found already, yet only indirectly, though. You cannot directly see them or detect them because distances are so great that optical light telescopes cannot possibly see them. Also, they are too close to the sun, and the sun, of course, has more light, but they're indirect methods which look at the positional changes of the planets. And by the way, that's a typical way of simplifying things. We see the Earth moves around the Sun, or the planets move around the Sun. That is correct, relatively speaking, but you should really say that Earth and Sun are moving around a common center of gravity. But since the Sun is so much more heavier, the center of gravity is within the Sun. So if planets move around the Sun, the move just wobbles a bit, a pendulum movement, because of the masses that move. And so extraterrestrial planets can be proven by using these methods. So it must be the right kind of sun. Here we have the stars that we know, our own sun, and we have the luminosity, and you can see how strong luminosity can be. And we have spectral classes, OB, AFG, our sun is so-called G star, and KM. And the transition from O to M, we see that's from blue to red. OB, AFG, I think that's easy to remember. All astronomers know that exactly, or all astrophysicians, physicists understand that. Oh, be a fine girl, kiss me. That's how they remember that. Now, let's turn to the planets. Here in the middle, again, our Earth and the habitable or life zones. Venus is slightly outside, too close to the Sun. Mars slightly outside. And the habitable zone depends very much on the mass of the Sun. The higher or bigger the Sun, the further out the habitable Sun, because the temperature gradient is not as strong as in smaller suns. You might say, hooray, we have to look for large suns because they offer a larger area, a larger life zone. No, that's not true. The suns must be similar to our Sun as far as the diameter is concerned, because suns that are much larger than ours sort of waste the energy they have, and they don't usually live that long. Usually it's less than 1 billion years, and that doesn't leave a lot of time for evolution, does it?
And it's different for the dwarf stars. They are not as bright, but they have a very long life. And here the planet really has to be very close to the sun already, so that there a habitable zone could exist. And you know, this corridor is also very small, very narrow, but it's not precluded. The probability goes down, but in that corridor, life could exist. And one exoplanet has been proved already, that's orbiting a red dwarf. Here you can see an illustration, an animation. It's emitting an orange yellow light and dips everything into that warm light. Whether life really exists, we don't know, but this planet has been proven theoretically. Theoretically, it's in a habitable zone. There's other factors you need to include, though, like the mass has to be right, and our moon, it's also in a fully habitable zone, but the mass is too small. There's no atmosphere, and for that reason, there can be no life. Let's now approach another item that I would also like to touch upon. You know, while we're talking about cosmic systems and order and how we're related to everything, let's ask what happens after we die. And here you can see the Australian brain researcher John Eccles, who also won a Nobel Prize. He was the first one to create the foundation of the quantum physics understanding of the brain. And he was always convinced of the immortality of the soul. And he said something like, the soul will continue to exist even after the nerve cells have died, after we die. He then went on to say that the coupling with the quantum fields might just connect our consciousness with the world spirit, which is all over the universe, according to him. This world spirit was no other than God himself to him. And this is the end of my presentation for today, and it's always good if you have a theory and also a picture to go with it. And I was thinking of the iceberg for my presentation. The iceberg may be born in the Davis Strait in Greenland, that's where the glaciers drop off their offspring into the ocean, and that's how the icebergs get created. And what we see, that's only roughly speaking 10% above the surface of the water. About 90% are beneath the surface. And our material world, the way that we experience it, that's like the tip of the iceberg. But what's underneath, below the surface, that's our intuition that we also live, like how we're connected to everything else. And the iceberg also has a lot of information that it carries, like its own history, the crystalline structures, and so on and so forth. And it's in constant interaction with the ambient water, exchanging information with it. And at some point, one day, it's going to melt. Just like we are connected to the whole universe, and we only experience the tip of the iceberg consciously. And one day, the iceberg has fully melted, and that's death. And all the information that was included, well, it kind of got transferred into the ocean, just like our information, our soul will one day move into cosmos for good. And then out of the ocean, water is going to be evaporate, will be condensating, will be snow that's going to be falling. And one day, a new iceberg is going to be born from it, and the circuit is going to be starting again. Thank you for your kind attention.